So in this video, I am going to discuss the concept of pipelining, and I will start with what is pipelining, what does it mean by taking a real life example, and how we can extend the idea to our DSP systems, and how we can increase their speed, or we can use this concept to decrease their power. So consider this machine. This machine is performing three tasks, that is washing, drying and ironing. And let's assume that each task takes T amount of time, T unit of time. So this machine will first wash, then dry the cloth and then perform the ironing. So this is the sequence, and finally the output is produced. So total time will be 3T. Suppose if you have provided a cloth to this machine, so for T time this machine will wash, and during this washing task this dryer and ironing unit will remain idle. Then after that the cloth will be transferred to this dry unit and it will take T time again. And during this washing unit and ironing unit will be idle, and after that this will be finally transferred to ironing unit and it will take T time to process the cloth, and we will receive the processed cloth after time 3T. Since this is a single unit, we cannot provide second cloth till the first cloth is completely processed, and for that we have to wait for time 3T. You can see that these three different units are packed in a single system, and whenever one unit is working the remaining two units are in idle states. So by any means, if we can make these three units independent, so by any means, if there is any means, we can make them independent, means washing a different unit, dryer a different unit and ironing a different unit. Instead of merging them in a single unit, now we have three units, that is first unit, this is performing washing, this is performing drying and this is performing ironing. Now let's see what will be the case if we provide some input to this machine. So now I have three independent units, first is washer, second is dryer and third is performing ironing, and each task is taking time, let's say T, and I am assuming that negligible time will be required to transfer clothes from washer to dryer and from dryer to this unit. So at T equal to 0, I will provide cloth 1 to washer unit, and these two units will be in idle state because we have to follow the sequence, first washing, then drying, then ironing, and it will perform the washing in time T. So after time T, the cloth C1 is washed, and now we can transfer it to a dryer B. So cloth 1 can be transferred to dryer D. Now it will start drying this clothes, and you can see that this unit is free, so we can provide a cloth 2 for washing, and this unit is still idle. So after a time T, the drying of this cloth C1 will be completed, and now it can be transferred to the unit I. Now C1 will be in unit I, and this unit is free, so we can transfer cloth C2 to this unit for drying, and now this unit is free, so you can provide cloth C3, and at the end of this cycle we will receive the processed cloth C1. So you have provided input at interval 0, and after 2T you have received the output. Okay, so assuming that these are different cycles, cycle 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, assuming that these are different cycles, so you are getting output after 3 cycles. So this is called latency. Latency, time difference between the first input given to the system and corresponding output received. Okay, after that, C2 will be transferred to I, C3 will be transferred to D, and a new cloth can be given to system W. And at the end of the cycle 3T, you will receive process cloth C2. And during fourth cycle, C3 can be transferred to I, C4 can be transferred to D, and new cloth can be introduced to washer, and you will receive output C3. So after a gap of 3 cycles, now you are receiving output after a gap of T. So you have significantly reduced the processing time from 3T to T. So this is the concept of pipelining, that divide the tasks that can be performed independently and make them work in parallel. Here you can see that at 2T all the three units are processing different loads. They are working in parallel on different loads. So this is the concept of pipelining, and this is exhaustively used in automobile industry or cloth industry, or it can be used in any kind of industries to optimize the processing time of the samples. So this idea of pipelining can be used to increase the speed of DSP system. And earlier I have mentioned that to increase the speed, or we can say that to increase the sampling rate, we need to decrease the critical path time. Okay, and to decrease the critical path time, we need to decrease the length of critical path. So now I have taken a simple DSP system which is representing the equation yn is equal to x1n plus x2n plus x3n, and talking about its critical path, it is the longest set of combinational element in series without any delay element. So this is the critical path of this circuit, and suppose TA time is taken by the adder to perform addition, so critical path time will be TA plus TA, that is 2TA. So this concept is already discussed in my previous videos. So this DSP system with two adder is behaving like a single unit which is adding two signal, x1n plus x2n plus x3n, and suppose the input is given, the first input is given at time t, so the final output will be received after time t plus 2ta. So here you can see that this adder a0, let's say this is a1 and this is a0, so a1 is dependent on adder a0. A1 cannot perform its computation till the output from a0 is received. So it will take t amount of time to add x1 and x2n, and it will generate output. And after that, a1 can add output of a0 and x3n. So x1, x2, x3n are source node. So here we are assuming that they can generate output at any time. Just we have to wait for the output of the computational unit. So TA time taken by this adder, further TA time taken by this adder, total time is 2TA. So if anyhow we can make this two adder independent, we will be able to reduce this critical path time from 2TA to a lower value. So during modification, I have to keep in my mind that this functionality, that the equation, the system that it is representing, should not change, its functionality should not change. So to reduce the critical path, I have to reduce this critical path length. it means that I have to make these two adder A0 and A1 independent, and that I can do by introducing a delay element in between. So a delay element is introduced between A0 and A1, and now I have to do some modifications, like instead of giving x3 n at this point, I have to provide x3 n minus 1. So this circuit is representing the equation x1 n minus 1 plus x2 n minus 1 plus x3 n minus 1. Okay, so for y1, the right hand side will be x10 plus x20 plus x30. For y2, the right hand side will be x11 plus x21 plus x31 and so on. So for n, time interval n, I am receiving output corresponding to the sample n minus 1. So this is latency. Okay, so having latency in circuit does not create any problem. Latency is allowed. So it is representing the same circuit. Just a basic difference is that at this point, at nth interval, I will receive the output corresponding to the sample n, and for this circuit I will receive the output corresponding to n minus 1 sample at interval n. So let's see that how this modified circuit is working. So at t equal to 0, A0 will be provided with input x0, x10 and x20, and it will perform addition on x10 and x20. So at this stage there is no use of delay element and adder A1, so it will take time TA. So after time TA, it will perform the addition. The addition of x10 and x20 will be completed, and now it can be transferred to this latch, and via this latch it will be transferred to adder A1. So for this delay element should be clocked. So T clock is starting my processing at T equal to 0. T clock should be at T clock minimum. So this concept is also discussed previously. So this adder A0 will generate output x10 plus x20 at time TA, and at this instant, if I provide a clock to this latch, this output will be stored in this latch and that will be reflected to its output. So assuming that latching takes negligible amount of time, so at instant TA, x10 plus x20 is available at the output of the latch. x10 plus x20 is available at the output of the latch, and now A1 can perform addition on its input signal. All the inputs are available, so A1 is performing addition on this two signal x10 plus x20 from latch and x30 from this side. So since we have stored this result in a latch, this is now free. There is no need to maintain the output at this point because we have already stored this output in this latch. So this is free, and we can introduce new sample, that is x11 and x21. So it can start processing new samples x11 and x21. So at 2 TA, so this adder will take further T amount of time to perform this computation, and the result will be available at the end of the cycle TA. So at 2 TA, this computation will also take T amount of time, and this is also taking T amount of time. So now this result need to be latched again to this shift register, and A1 will perform computation of new input. So next clock should be provided at 2 TA. So this x1 plus x21 will be shifted to this shift register. So at 2 TA, the clock pulse will arrive at this shift register, and the output from adder A0, that is x11 plus x21, will be latched to this shift register, and A1 will start performing computation on x11 plus x21, that is from latch, and x31, that is from this input source, and this is now free, so it can perform addition on new samples, that is x12 plus x22. Okay, so first output is received at interval TA after a gap of TA, and after that, after a gap of TA, so at this point you will receive output y0. After gap of TA you will receive y1, and so on. So you have to wait for one interval, that is TA. You can say that this TA is a T clock, so in terms of clock cycle you can say that you have to wait for one clock cycle to receive the first output. After that you will receive output at every clock interval. So this is latency. Okay, and now sampling time is, also equal to clock time, that is equal to TA, and you can see that now critical path consists of this adder or this adder. So critical path time is also TA. So this sampling time and the clock time is equal to critical path time. So just by reducing the critical path time of this circuit, the reduction in clock time and sampling time is achieved, and since sampling time is reduced, sampling rate is increased.